bottom, barely could find a pot to piss in. And you would know the truth if you could humble down and listen. We're the gods of the earth, they just modified our pictures. And since they at the top, well, we coming back to get them. Every lesson that I learned gave me solutions to my issues. Survivor of the righteous, see these laws supposed to push. But if you hated Christ, I just know the feeling's mutual. Like the chills run down my spine when red and blue flash through my mirrors. See the black men, they're in fear. If you're an Israelite, they shiver. See, I'ma walk the footprints of my fathers. When you come to serve the Lord, it's best a man up or don't bother. Pay attention, we're part of the rebirth of our nation.
Come on, we're gonna leave the heathens rule over us. How long shall we stick to the bottom, Israel? We gotta take my whole nationality or our crown. This is ours, the world is ours.
Situation, you'd have to put me through a simple service examination.
No, stupid. You mean a civil service examination.
Well, a man carried me in a little room and set me down and started asking me a gang of questions.
Well, what'd he ask you?
First thing the man asked me, say, how far is it from the sun to the moon?
He asked you how far it was from the sun to the moon?
Yeah, that's what the man asked me.
Well, what'd you tell him?
I told him if he was going to give me that route, I didn't want to judge.
Well, tell me, how would you like to go to work for me?
Yes, ma'am. How much you gonna pay me, I hope?
Well, let's see now. Mm-hmm. I'll pay you all your worth.
No, ma'am. I gotta have some money.
All right, shalom, Israel. Most High in Christ bless. I'm Officer Mendel.
And I'm Officer Jeshurun.
We're here today at the Congressional Black Caucus 2019. And right now, we're actually at the prayer breakfast. It's about to kick off, or it's kicking off, where you got your politicians, your pastors, and your everyday folks. So we're going to check it out and see what type of solutions they're talking about bringing to the community and see whether they're going to have biblical solutions or not. So just stay tuned and we'll check back in later. With that, we say shalom. Most High in Christ bless.
What it needs, stand against our enemies because we can. Yeah. Take one and another will rise up. We'll endure until we reach the end. End. We are gods, we are kings, demanding change because we believe we can.
What y'all sisters up here for?
I'm sorry?
What was y'all sisters up here for?
For the prayer breakfast.
What happened at the prayer breakfast? Let us know what happened.
So at the prayer breakfast, they had the pastor from Alfred Baptist Church.
Okay. So what did he go over?
He fired us up. He was saying, using it back to Joshua when people said when they were calling to energize, they had a prayer breakfast too.
Uh-huh.
They said the Lord came in the midst of their prayer.
Uh-huh.
He's like, there's a time to pray, but there's a time for the prayer to end. He had to be about acting. He's like, I'm with you always.
What was he telling y'all to do?
He's saying that politically at this point, prayer is nice, but we prayed about making political change, so now it's time to go into action. So prayer is over.
Do you think so? Are the solutions in our community? I'm just speaking about the black community. Is this something that can be solved in politics? Do you think politicians can solve it?
Politics, what?
Can fix the problems in the black community.
I think it can be one of the solutions and not the solution. You can't put all our faith in politics. Politics are people. You can't put all your faith in man. It's going to crush you every time. People have their own They had their own ideas.
Right, right. So, was he telling people to go out and vote for the Democrats?
No, it wasn't about voting at all. It was about mobilizing and making change. What you need to do. Can't talk. Basically, his message was don't talk about it, be about it.
Right. Well, what the definition of sin is? You gotta be honest with yourself.
I don't attend Sunday school.
They ain't teaching that. Did you go to Sunday school?
I don't go to Sunday school.
I'm saying, did you ever go to Sunday school?
When I was
born. So why you don't remember that?
Because I wasn't always at a church. I just came to that church.
Okay. All right, we're gonna show you, brother. We're gonna learn here in a matter of seconds. Here you go, brother. Right in front. This was sin.
Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law.
Uh-huh.
For sin is the transgression of the law.
So sin is breaking God's law. So now if I ask you, is it okay for you, for a man to shave his head bald according to the Bible?
Yes, is it okay?
Yeah.
I believe it should be okay.
Okay, so let's get that. Get Leviticus 20. Here's the problem. The church ain't teach you the laws of God. It's not okay according to Leviticus 21. It said, remember, this is a law. It said, sin is breaking of God's laws. Read one of the laws.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 21 and verse 5. They shall not make baldness upon their head.
They shall what?
Not make baldness upon their head.
Anytime you see thou shalt not, that's a commandment, regardless of what it is. Read.
Neither shall they shave off the corner of their beard.
Uh-huh.
Nor make any cuttings in their flesh.
Right, so you're not supposed to shave your face bald, and you're not supposed to get tattoos or brand yourself. According to God, those are three different laws, well, four different laws right there in one. Now if I ask you, is it okay for you to eat pork?
I believe that's enough. That's the Muslim not allowed to eat pork.
Get that. Let's see.
The book of
the...
Oh. All right,
bro. Okay. Hey, grab a flag. So, but we got to know what sin is, though. Like, a lot of us, we got to know what sin is. Like, we ask people all the time. Bro, what's the mark, bro?
The mark is what indoctrinated us to believe that they
can tell. Right, so here's the thing. That's very generic. Look at us specifically. What does God tell us to do and what does he tell us not to do? That's the thing. We don't know these things. We haven't been like, if I ask you, what's the biblical definition of sin according to God? Where would you tell me to go to prove that? We're not supposed to do Christmas according to God.
Yeah.
That's not biblical.
It's not biblical.
You want to read it, sis? You believe in the Bible?
Of course I do. Yeah.
Okay, so then you're going to believe what's written. Read right there. It's King James.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 10, verse 2. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen,
uh-huh,
and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them.
Uh-huh.
For the customs of the people are vain.
Vain just means no good. It's a lie.
For one cutteth a tree out of the forest.
So this particular custom, hold on, sis, we going over some history, sis. So this particular custom, they cut a tree out of the forest.
The work of the hands of the workmen with the axe.
So you got to cut it down with an axe.
They decorate it. With silver and with gold.
They decorate it with silver and gold.
They fasten it with nails and hammers, that it move not.
They put in a tree stand.
But
so what
this is
that?
Old Testament.
Correct.
This is Old Testament.
What does that mean?
Old Testament.
Give me two
Babylons.
No, get okay. Get Hebrews.
This is eight, Old Testament. You're putting Old Testament before Christ.
Okay, we're gonna read it after.
So after Christ, Christmas. So,
when did they start celebrating Christmas after the death of Christ?
In the Bible.
When the apostles, I read through the book of Acts. When the book of Acts, specifically that's going after the death of Christ, when did they ever celebrate Christmas?
When they had Jesus Christ.
I'm talking about Acts. Acts, Christ stayed in the book of Acts. When did the apostles celebrate Christmas?
The apostles came after Christ was going around, picking up his disciples.
Okay.
Therefore,
I understand.
Christmas cannot be after his disciples. Christmas came at the birth of Jesus Christ.
Where in the Bible? What happened?
Where in the
when
Bible?
When he was born.
So what?
We are celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ.
No, you're celebrating the birth of Nimrod.
No, yes. We're celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ.
No, you're not, sis.
We're not celebrating Christmas for nothing. We just in remember, says, just like you celebrate your birthday.
You're not supposed to do that.
That's what we're doing.
Christ wasn't born. Guess when Christ was born? Christ was born in the springtime. Says he was born at Passover. We're gonna get that Luke 2:40. Why would he be celebrating his birthday in December? Now you ain't gonna lose nothing. You about to gain some understanding here. That's you ain't losing nothing.
Do not read Jeremiah to anyone.
Look, we read the whole Bible, sis. You talking evil? Read that.
The book of Luke chapter 2, verse 40. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him.
Okay.
Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover.
Okay.
And when he was at 12 years old.
So when Christ turned 12, read it again.
Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover.
Passover was always in the springtime, celebrating the month of Abib, which means ear of corn. That's when things are coming back to life. God is a God of life.
And when he was 12 years old,
no
they went up to Jerusalem after
the Passover. You don't have no validation. Show me verses in the Bible.
Because we celebrate
No, you don't, sis.
We celebrate Christmas.
No, you don't, sis. You celebrate Christmas because you celebrate Satan.
That is just in remembrance
no,
of Christ.
It's not a command.
God.
No, it's not. Christ was born in the springtime. That's what it says.
He could be born in the springtime.
So why would you celebrate him
the
in the
situation, the condition when he was born wasn't conducive for any celebration anyway.
You celebrate your birthday 7 months after he was born?
It doesn't matter when they celebrated it.
Sis, you sound crazy.
But someone came up that his birth was celebrated.
No. We know when they came up. They was already
stop
celebrating.
Stop arguing vaguely. Seek the Holy Spirit.
Sis, you ain't
stop
got the Holy Spirit.
Stop arguing vaguely. Let the Holy Spirit lead you.
What's the Holy
whatever
Spirit?
Conversation you're having.
Christmas is not the Bible.
Old Testament.
Christmas is not the Bible.
Jeremiah.
New Testament when he was born.
No, but you went back.
So Luke Old Testament?
No, you.
Luke Old. I'm asking. It's Luke Old Testament.
You started by saying Jeremiah.
Give me 1 Corinthians.
Jeremiah was before Christ.
And 34. Is that what I want?
Like Corinthians 2?
No, 14 and 34. I'm on 1 Corinthians.
Why you
are you
Lord
don't
why is it
the
problem?
The
why,
book of
1
Corinthians, chapter
why
14, verse 34.
This is the problem. I'll start at verse 33.
33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace.
See, God ain't the author of confusion, sis, but
thank
of peace.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Has the community since we've been voting since 1965 gotten better or has it gotten worse? I'm asking you. You are older gentleman, you should be able to know that.
Well, I don't think that politics is the only ill that we have. I think parenting.
But they gotta be taught though. That's
I understand that. So what I'm saying is that I don't want to put everything on Democrats or Republicans.
Right.
We have to put it on parenting. The family was broken,
right?
It was slavery,
right?
The families were separated.
And boomers are broken again. It was broken twice. It was broken in order for...
It was broken
in 1965.
In the 60s, yes.
So who put that in effect? J. Edgar Hoover. In order for the system to get on welfare, who had to be out of the house?
Well, J. Edgar Hoover, a Democrat?
What's his name? Lyndon B. Johnson. Lyndon B. Johnson became over the Great Society Act. He was a Democrat. He's on record saying I'm gonna have these niggas vote Democrat for the next 200 years.
But at the end of the day, you know, I'm going to reject the notion of what you're talking about because at the end of the day,
no, it's not rejecting. I'm just saying that's historical facts.
This is how I feel. So I'm gonna say what I have to say.
Right.
So I'm gonna reject what you're saying because we fought our way through slavery. We can fight our way through anything.
You understand?
400 years.
That's what y'all here
we
teaching.
We can fight our way through anything.
Right, but we gotta have the problem.
We can't place the blame on one particular.
Here's the thing, because we get defensive, we're having an intellectual discussion.
I'm not getting defensive, but I'm making my statement. So if you're taking it, me being defensive, that's what I'm saying. But I'm making a statement, emphatic about it because I'm deeply rooted in the political process, and I'm deeply rooted with the people.
I can tell. And
what
else?
These are my people.
Right, so what I'm saying is, we gotta look at it. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over, expecting different results. Our communities have been controlled with certain politics and it hasn't helped. they've gotten worse. What we out here teasing is that we got to come, we got to come with this.
That's one aspect of it. I just came out of a program here, Prayer Breakfast, and the last thing that the preacher said was get up off your knees and get out there and fight again.
Right, but
you understand what I'm saying? So prayer is not all answers.
I'm answering like, I'm not saying about prayer. Specifically, how do we go about fighting? Like, what is the steps that we got to do to fix our community? Because it's all good to pump people up. I'm saying specifically, what was laid out systematically, a process like a McDonald's. They got a system. Everywhere you go, everything's the same. What kind of system is being laid out? Because it sounds good, I get it. It sounds, I'm saying, what steps are laid out to address these specific problems? What I'm asking.
Well, again, there's no silver bullet to anything in life. You're gonna have to use a program of solutions. It's not one silver bullet, but it's the family, it's the faith, it's your environment, it's a lot of different things.
Well, the Lord lays out the silver bullet. That's the silver bullet. We gotta come back to who we are.
Again,
come back to the life.
Again, I go back to the sermon that we had today. Yes, God teaches us to pray for our needs, and sometimes you can take God's word and God will say, "I will fight your battle for you." In this particular passage, in Joshua 7, he said, "I will go and fight with you." We can't all depend on him to just give our problems to God. Sometimes we have to fall to our knees and pray, and God will go out to the battlefield fight.
I'm gonna have him read this real quick. This is one of the solutions that you don't have to do on your knees. It actually takes action. Read that.
The book of Exodus, chapter 22, verse 16.
Speak up so again. Exodus 22 and 16.
And if a man entice a maid.
So if a brother entice a maid, meaning he runs game on her.
That is not betrothed.
She's not promised to another man.
And lie with her.
Have sex with her.
He shall surely endow her to be his wife.
He got to marry the sister. So now, boom. That's millions of brothers off of, town support. Now you got a man in the house. The problem is what's being taught is whoremongering. It's in the rap videos, it's pussy society. They're selling sex everywhere, so people hop from person to person to person. That's an outline solution. If a brother has sex with a sister, you gotta marry that sister. And you can't, under Christ, you can't put that sister away. You gotta die with that sister. That's the solution.
So one solution.
Right, but okay, that's more than one. God, all the solutions that you talk about, that you see in our community, all the solutions are in there. They just not being taught in the church. Because if it was, our people would know that.
Just like you out here today, you're not in the four walls of the church. So other pastors and ministers and other people have to get out into the community and do the
that's
work.
That's what we teach on the street. We got brothers outside
all
over the world.
And that's what I'm trying to say. You have to come out of the four walls of the church.
Right.
And so do the parishioners. Get out there and do the work.
Can I show you a video really quick?
No, I got it.
All right, go ahead, brother.
Okay. Thank you.
All right,
thank
you.
Enjoy.
Enjoy.
The truth is that, brother, you've been living under false identity. You are a product of slavery. What's your last name?
Edwards.
That's a slave master. You think your forefather's last name was Edwards when they came off the slave ship?
I hope not.
It wasn't. It was Ben Israel. If it was a man, it was Bot Israel. If it was a daughter. What you got?
This is the book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 142. Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth.
God's law is the truth. It's setting us free from slavery. Setting us free from the mental bondage that we're black. We're niggas, we're coons, African American. Brother, you are an Israelite, brother. That's your God-given heritage. The other label, any other label outside of that is what the white man put as a slave title. Like, that's why we got these books in here. They tell you plainly who the Israelites are. That's why we got these books up here. Their authors tell you that they Edomites, right, and they not the real Jews. As you when you read Revelation 2 and 9 and 3 and 9, we didn't write none of these books. These books put together by white folks. That's telling you that you're Israelite, but what's the saying? If you want to hide something from a black man, where you put it?
In the book.
Put it in the book. they know most people don't read. That's why God said my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
Why do you think the first thing that tells them is telling them you can't read? You can't read the Bible.
That was the only book that was in publication. You would have got killed in 1619, 18, you read this. If this book was for everybody, why wouldn't they want you reading? Why was you being put to death for reading this? It don't even make sense, because they know that this is your book. You don't know that name. And that's where we are today. That's why our community is in shambles, because we've been robbed of our heads. Get in there, Jeremiah. This is why our people are the way that we are. We're trying to restore our people according to the word of the Lord. Not Christianity, what we've been doing.
Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 4. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage.
So he's telling that to Jeremiah that you and your people are going to be discontinued from your heritage. If something is discontinued, what that means? If something is discontinued, say that camera is discontinued, what does that mean?
Not made anymore. No longer available.
It can't no longer available. So that's going on. We will lose. I'm going to read this. It's around 17.
Thy heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not.
He's talking about in America. When you was getting beat and thrown in the deck of that slave ship, was the white man your friend? Was he your friend in 1619? Right, so the Lord is telling you going to serve your enemies. The reason why we think he's our friend now, because Ecclesiastes 7 and 7 says, a wise man, oppression makes a wise man
mad,
but a gift destroys the heart. When they gave us wealth and equal rights and all that, we fell back and said, you know what, this man loves us. How? Because he ruined us with that gift.
Book of Sirach, chapter 20, verse 29. Presents and gifts blind the eyes of the wise.
You see that? Presents and gifts blind the eyes of the wise. Hey, y'all niggas going firm in the back. You can sit in the same toilet seat as us. We went right back to sleep because we was wise, we was marshes, we wanted this, we wanted that. As soon as he gave us these crumbs, we fell back. We like, ah, man, that's my friend, he loves me. But 60 years ago, you wouldn't have been rubbing elbows with the white man. Say, get your black ass out of here. You sitting over here, boy. But because of the gift, we think everything is all good. That's showing you the truth. Make no mistake, they still your enemy, brother. That ain't nothing changed.
Ain't nothing changed.
That's what the Lord, that's what he's telling me. It's a harsh reality, especially under the political correctness when we say certain things.
Right.
The black man has been so effeminized through the advancement of the Willie Lynch letter, hyperdrive in the 21st century with the gay effeminate rap. You know, you can't even say things. You talk about the alphabet community.
They say you're homophobic.
You can't say this, you can't say that, because of the black man has been effeminized right here in America.
And if you read a fact of the Bible, they say you hate me. You're homophobic or something. You're condemning me. You preach a hate. So reading the Bible preach a hate. That's bad.
So that's what y'all here to teach. The Bible makes the black man, which is a boy, into a man. Like, it's just all little boys in our country. Straight up be out here whipping the white man across his back with whips because he did that to us. Read it again.
Recompense no to no man evil for evil.
We're not going to go evil for evil with no man. That's what the Lord say, read.
Provide things honest in the sight of all men.
Do what?
Provide things honest in the sight of all men.
So we provide things honest in the sight of all men. We don't double deal. We don't do under the table with nobody. That's a commandment of the Lord.
If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men.
That's what the Lord commands us to do. Give me Hebrews 12 and 14. Don't mistake truth for hate. That's the thing. Because of the political correctness, they blurred the lines.
Yeah. I'm just saying, like a lot of people I talk to, like they'll go to the hate and then. Well, you guys ask, you got to answer correctly, because it's like, you know, hating your brother the same as her.
But no, the white man, I can't stand that Negro right there. That's a murderous spirit. That's why I'm black on black crime exists, because your identity has been stolen. When I look at you, I'm supposed to see Christ. But when I look at you, because of this image that's been pushed throughout the world, which is the image of the beast, I see another nigga. I see my enemy. Because of the condition of slavery. Read that thing.
Hebrews 12 and 14. Follow peace with all men.
Do what?
Follow peace with all men.
Uh-huh.
And holiness.
Uh-huh.
Without which no man shall see the Lord.
You see that? So we follow peace with all men. But we're going to let the white man know what it is.
Bible calls him the devil. The devil just means deceiver. How can I say that claim? He knows you're an Israelite. He's got a document in several of the history books we got of it, but he calls you an African American. That's deceit. That's deceit. He knows that the worship day, according to the Bible, is supposed to be Saturday, but he's got everybody going on Sunday. That's deceit. Their scholars know that. Let me show you something. They've iconoclasted the images of your forefathers. When you look up all the images of your forefathers, they were all men of color. I'm gonna show you, this is how bold they are, how they know black folks don't read. I'm gonna show you some artists dispatched by the Vatican, some Jesuit priests. They in here literally whitewashing and iconoclasting the images that have been found all throughout Europe. Black images of Christ, the Most High God, and the angels. They showing you what they doing. Who is this man?
Black.
Give me Job 9:24. You about to see a literal depiction of what Job 9:24 says. I'm gonna leave this up for illustration purposes. So, because we command to give the sense of the Bible.
The book of Job, chapter 9, and verse 24. The earth is given into the hands of the wicked.
Who's running the earth right now? What race of people is running the earth? Be real, buddy.
What race of people is running the earth right now?
Right. Don't be ashamed to say it, brother. He is. Who can go into a country telling people where and where they can't fly a plane? The white man. Who just drops bombs in a sovereign country?
Right.
He's flying drones over there blowing people up. It ain't the Chinese man. It ain't the Arab man. It's the white man. See, the earth is given into the hands of the wicked, letting you know who the wicked is. Because he's running the earth.
He covers the faces of the judges.
This man covers the faces of the judges. You see how they done lighten that up over time? They just can't slap like that. They got a layer. Eventually, they got to look up like that. Look at that. It's gold. It's we're going to show you some darker images, but that's how they got it. Say, he covered the face of the judges.
Thereof,
if not,
where? And who is he?
Show me photographs or historical documentation where you see the Chinese man painting images of Christ into their image. You don't see. That's you can see a pictorial representation of what we literally just read in Job. That's why we got these books out here.
That's documented too. I'm reading for you. Yeah, this is the book, Nature Knows No Color Line.
Written by J.A. Rogers.
The Christians had gained power. They had become mighty. Christ had become a king, and it would no longer suit to portray him as unimpressive in appearance. So him being dark-skinned, like the Bible says to them, is unimpressive in appearance.
Right.
That's what they wanted to change. The original text says Eisler would give offense to believing Christians and the Hellenistic ideal of male beauty. Therefore, they changed the pen picture of Christ to ruddy, 6 foot high, well-grown, venerable, erect, handsome, blue eyes, beautiful mouth, copious beard. A portrait of Christ entirely apocryphal and with absolutely no foundation in truth. So the portion of Christ that they showed to us is no truth in that at all. That was based on Pope Alexander's son, Caesar Borgia. If you Google this, it's common knowledge. The portion of Christ we have today is based off Caesar Borgia.
That's
why it's slavery. This is what they didn't want to free them.
This ain't hate. That's why a lot of brothers, you got to start shaking that effeminate spirit. You just getting the truth uncut. We didn't say anything hateful or offensive about the white man. We just giving you the truth. Who's destroying the planet? Who's polluting the air? Who's pulling all the oil out of the earth? Wonder why the planet heats.
Right.
You're pulling all the cooling fluid out of the earth. Foolish, man.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ.
The revealing of Jesus Christ. The Lord knew Christ had to be revealed because he knew the false image would be put up and set upon the standard on earth.
Which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass.
Uh-huh.
And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
Uh-huh.
So we know in our terms today, he stamped it. He made it. It's official.
Right.
So verse 14. His head and his hairs were white like wool.
So now, who has white woolly hair here out of these two images? Right, read, keep reading.
As white as snow.
Uh-huh, keep reading, just read.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire.
So Christ had red eyes. This color you'll see, his eyes was red.
And his feet like unto fine brass.
Brass is the derivative of brown.
As if they burned in a furnace.
Now, if I burn white rice in the furnace, what color is that white rice going to turn? If I burn it,
black.
Right. So what is it saying about Christ? If he looked like something brown right. burned in the furnace, what is it saying about Christ?
Skin texture is black.
He's a very dark skin.
Burn. If you burn white rice, it goes to pitch black. So imagine burning grass that's already a dark tone.
Christ was a very dark skinned brother,
like Wesley Snipes type black.
Yes.
That was a very black man. And people make fun of that today. You know, if you're the darker you are, they say the more ugly you are. That's what they say, that's what they teach.
And that's why you got such things as black on black crime, identity crisis. You see women and men walking around with blonde hair. And this is, and brothers, dark as your shirt with blonde hair.
And to answer the question you might be having is, why does it matter? Let's see what Christ said out of his own mouth. A lot of people say that, why does it still matter?
38?
Yes, sir. The book of John, chapter 7, verse 38, red letters. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said.
Now, as the picture in my pastor told me.
As the scripture hath said.
Uh-huh.
Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Right, so the scripture said Christ is a dark-skinned man with white woolly head. So a brother telling you that, out of his mouth shall flow rivers of living water. So if you sit in an establishment that's got a blonde hair, blue eye, or they tell you it don't matter,
right.
you get stagnant. Deadly water, brother. That's what Christ said. That's what we're gonna be doing as it's written. We celebrate Hanukkah. We got the Day of Atonement coming up, where we got a fast for a whole day. And that's on the day where the Lord wipe all your sins clean. After that, we got the Feast of Tabernacles. We keep that. Christ kept the Feast of Tabernacles. Give me that John chapter 6 real quick. John chapter 6. Because if we follow on Christ, and Christ is walking to the Feast of Tabernacles, and you go and make the left and go to Halloween, are you following after Christ?
Absolutely. Look at John chapter 7 verse 2. Now the Jews' feast at Tabernacles was at hand. His brother, verse 1. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee. So he would not walk in Jewry because the Jews sought to kill him.
Right, just black on black crime even back then.
Now the Jews' feast of Tabernacles was at hand.
The what?
The Jews' feast of Tabernacles was at hand. His brethren therefore said unto him, depart thence and go into Judea.
Right, because it was a commandment that three times a year all males had to appear in Jerusalem for three high holy days. It's Passover, Pentecost, and the Feast of Tabernacles. When you read Deuteronomy 16 and 16, that's why he went down to Judea to keep that. So how can I be a follower of Christ? How can I be a Christian? You understand what I'm saying?
So do you work on Sunday?
No. We work on Sunday. Yes, Sunday ain't the Sabbath. Today's the Lord's Sabbath.
Whatever day is the Sabbath.
Yeah, Friday. Here's how it goes. Friday, because the day goes from evening to evening. Friday sunset, when it's black outside, begins the Sabbath. And it ends on Saturday sunset. When you, like the 4 day when you read the Genesis, it's from evening to evening. So right now, we're in the Lord's Sabbath. We're not going to be doing no buying, selling, cooking, or cleaning.
Right.
We're going to be out here doing the Lord's work because that's what he's talking about. But as far as my labors, I'm not doing my personal labors. The Lord give me 6 days. Not to mention, if the seventh day was good enough for the Most High God to rest on, and he bade me, who am I to work on the day that he rested on?
So when the Pharisees came to Christ and said, why don't you do the thing that they prescribed in tradition? And he's like,
get the law on that. Christ wore the disciples out. I mean, the Pharisees out left and right. Read that for the brother.
The book of Matthew, chapter 12, and verse.
The last verse in the chapter.
Matthew 12 and verse 1. At the time Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples were in hunger, and began to pluck the ears of corn to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, behold, thy disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day. But he said unto them, have ye not read what David did when he was hungered, and they that were with him, how he entered into the house of God and did eat of the children, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests.
Right, so that was the point. But they said it was not lawful for him. They said when they the disciples out there making a point, they said they didn't sin. Let's
Right. The Lord said, in Deuteronomy 23:25, it says, when thou comest into the standing corn of thy neighbor, then thou mayest pluck the ears with thy hand, but thou shalt not move a sickle unto the neighbor's standing corn.
Right. So pluck corn and fire, then I have the receipts. Cut work, now be working on the neighbor, you know, get a problem. One tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh.
Eating what?
Swine's flesh.
Eating the pig.
And the abomination.
That go into your shellfish, your catfish.
And the mouse.
That goes into your possum, your raccoon, turtle stew.
Shall be consumed together, saith the Lord.
Say who?
Saith the Lord.
So if Christ come back and you got a pork chop sandwich, what you think gonna happen to you? Based on that prophecy, because everything that's happening gonna be true. Christ also said, I'm gonna do it for you. Did God ever claim pork?
Officer Mendel, IUIC DC, and we're here with
Shauna Grant.
Miss Shauna Grant. Okay, so you attended the prayer breakfast there?
Well, I'm volunteering with the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation.
Okay, so how long have you been a volunteer?
Since last Sunday.
Oh, so you just started. Okay, how much do you know about the Congressional Black Caucus?
Not that much. I know a few of the members after doing a little research to get acquainted. I should do more. But I know that they're a caucus that pushes issues and lobbies for policies that will positively affect the black community.
Okay, so I know that a lot of these politicians, some of them have been there for years, some of them for decades. So when we look at cities like Chicago, Detroit, and right up the street, Baltimore, where a lot of these politicians have been over top of these communities for a long time, but yet our people are in waste. Why do you think that is?
Well, it's oftentimes hard for someone who's 20 years older than the people that they're representing to understand what the constituents want and need. So getting new people into office and getting new people representing them is maybe the change that we need to improve our current.
Okay, so let me ask you this. Chicago had over 800 murders in Obama's last year. I don't know what the rate is now, but it's pretty high. So would you say that is that a political problem or a biblical problem?
That's a cultural problem. That's something that we have to address as black people, why we feel the need or feel it okay to harm one another when we're brothers and sisters. We've lost that sense of family when we were enslaved and taken from Africa. That culture.
Okay, so, and that's exactly what we're bringing here, because we're getting back to the roots. Because according to the Bible, we're the Israelites. So that history's been hidden from us. So like you said, and in our history, guess what? The Bible is in our history. So guess what the Bible tells us not to do? No, it tells us not to do that also, but it also tells us not to murder. It tells you not to enslave your own people. But the point I'm talking about as far as murder in Chicago, so one of the commandments is thou shalt not kill. So that's why I asked you, did you think that was, like, what can a politician do to stop that? Because I honestly believe that those are biblical problems.
I agree with that as a biblical problem as a Christian, but for people who don't have the connection to God that I do or that you have, it could be addressed in a different way.
Okay, so I think that, do you think that it would help, like, if some of these pastors would go out on the street and teach the people not to kill, or should they just wait for the drug dealers and the murderers to come into the church?
I mean, I think it's more than just religion. I mean, we live in a current society where religion doesn't dictate anything, doesn't dictate everything anymore. And it starts really, really young and then for primary education, getting kids to know that violence is not okay, it's not the answer, how to communicate, how to read, how to feel that they're learning and being educated at school so they don't feel like they need to leave school because they're not learning anything or they feel dumb, things like that, supporting children. So when they grow up, they want to further themselves instead of pulling back.
Okay, so, but a lot of these politicians that promise that they've, you know, put, like I said, some of them been there for decades. But, like, when you look at Baltimore, because we spend a lot of time in the inner cities. Like, we go out to the street to meet the people where they are, in the slums, in the ghettos. And the politicians don't seem to care about those people. They seem to be rejected. So a lot of these brothers that we have in our organization, they're from the streets. And the way that they're able to turn their lives around is by keeping God's commandments. Because God didn't give us religion. He gave us laws to go by. He gave us inheritance. So like you mentioned earlier, we don't have inheritance. So wouldn't you feel like it'd be important for pastors to go out and teach the people of where they're from, what their culture is? Because right now we don't have a culture. We've basically been assimilated here in America. Would you agree to that, or what's your thoughts on that?
As Black Americans, do we have a culture?
I said we don't. The culture that we have, we've been assimilated into. Everything that we know was given to us by our oppressor, including our history. So the religions, a lot of these religions is given to us by our oppressor. Like if you, okay, being a Christian, yeah, where in the Bible does it command us to go to church on a Sunday?
It commands us to go to church on the seventh day, which is a Saturday.
Okay, so.
Seventh day Adventist.
Okay, but a lot of people are not. They go to church on Sunday. You understand that? So where did we learn that from? Did we read that or were we taught that in a time period where we couldn't read or write?
Well, that stems from, like, the Catholic Church and their traditions, and then that got pushed down or pushed onto people who became slaves.
So, okay.
Yeah, we were forced. We were taught. It wasn't read.
Okay, so the people that became slaves, those are the Israelites. So when you read that flyer, like, hey, Jess, come on around. Let me show you a couple things. So now we talk about high crime in our communities, right? So would you agree that when you look at Baltimore, Chicago, any major city, we're at the bottom?
Can you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
Pretty much all the major cities around the United States where we live, we're at the bottom. Would you agree with that or not?
Yes.
Okay, so now I'm going to show you in the Bible where it says that. So now, as far as you've been taught in your church, according to God, is everybody equal or does God have a chosen people?
He has a chosen people.
Okay, so let's find out who the chosen people are. Go to Deuteronomy 28 and 15. No, start at 1. Let's go to 1.
Deuteronomy 28 and verse 1. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
Okay, so now in this scripture right here, it's telling the children of Israel that if they kept God's commandments, they would be above everybody. So now let's you got to go. Oh, she got to go. Look at the flyer, sister. Our information is on the back where you can learn about your history and why we are in the condition and the solutions. Because our solutions are going to be biblical. They're not going to be political. All right, shalom, everybody. I'm Officer Mendel from DC Camp, and I'm with...
This is Dr. Carol Crawford.
Okay, Dr. Carol Crawford. Okay, so what brings you here today?
I came to the prayer breakfast to represent National Cares through Susan Taylor. We have a National Capital Area Cares program right here in Washington, D.C.
Okay, so what do y'all do? Just tell us a little bit about what you do.
CARES is a mentorship program, and what we serve as for the youth community, we have different resources of mentors that come to us, and we send them out to other places to mentor students.
Okay. So let me ask you this. What is it that you hope to accomplish by coming here to the Black Congressional Caucus?
By coming to the Black Congressional Caucus, we hope to actually get more mentors of color, of course, to help go out and help the children, our children in the Black community, thrive. We need to make them self-aware. We need to help them grow through not just being knowledgeable, academically, but also emotionally, and to increase their mental health awareness.
Okay, so we sort of in the same business. We bring solutions biblically. Mm-hmm. What we teach our people is that their history according to the Bible.
Right.
So because we don't have a history. You understand that our history goes, when you say black history, we think about Harriet Tubman. 400 years. But where's the rest of the 5,000 years of history? Where is that?
The 5,000 years of history began in the continent, on the continent of Africa.
Okay. All right, I agree with you. It is on the continent of Africa. Hey, Jess, let's show the sister. She got to go. You can show this one scripture real quick, and then we're going to get you a flyer. Galatians 4. Yeah, you know what I want. Go ahead.
Galatians 4 and 26. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all.
So Jerusalem is where all life started. So, and that's where we come from. So that's the history that's hidden from us. When you look at that flyer, you'll find out that the slaves that were sold over here in America are the Jews of the Bible. That's what you'll find out. Yeah, exactly. Okay. All right. Okay. So then if... Okay, so then you know, did you know that we're under a curse, and that's why we're at the bottom of society?
The curse is broken. We are responsible for breaking that curse.
Okay.
See, the word of our tongue is sharper than any two-edged sword. So it's what you say that makes a difference. What you say is what goes into your head and into your heart. It comes out of your mouth, and also by what you hear.
Okay.
As well.
All right, so can I get you two more scriptures?
Absolutely.
Okay, so go to Deuteronomy 28 and 1. And then we're going to go to 28, and we're going to jump down to 15 and 16.
Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 1. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
So we're not on top right now. We're at the bottom. So let's read the flip side. Get that.
Deuteronomy 28 verse 15. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
Verse 16.
Cursed shalt thou be in the city.
So who's cursed in the city?
Who's cursing the city?
I said who's cursed in the city. When you
the city.
All the major cities in this country, who's at the bottom? That's an easy question.
The blacks are generally, or I should say the minorities, are generally the cursed in the city. But you've got to have the gift of faith.
Now, okay, faith, I agree with you on that.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So what you hope in your heart and speak out of your mouth is what really makes the difference in where you can go. Right? You got to change your mind.
I agree with that. So what we read was that we'd be at the top if we kept the commandments. But if we broke the commandments, we'd be at the bottom. One of the curses would be we'd be cursed in the city. So we're still cursed in the city. Now, when I get, we're going to keep reading.
Cursed shalt thou be in the city, and cursed shalt thou be in the field.
So we were cursed in the cotton fields today. What's the field today? The workforce. That's the workforce today.
But again, you have to break that curse.
We agree with
and
you, sister.
And you break that curse is by what you speak. Now, you know that I know that everybody don't believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, as the one who walked on the earth, right, in the Trinity. Everybody doesn't believe that. But when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you change your wording and what you think in your heart and in your mind, that's where the difference comes in. So you don't have to be cursed, right?
Well, what we just read is that you'd be cursed if you didn't keep the commandments, and you'd be blessed if you did. So in order for us to be blessed, according to the Bible, even under Christ, it says the same thing, we have to keep the commandments. Because when you look at...
You don't have to have a commandment of being cursed. That's not a commandment. That's the Old Testament. Switch over to the New Curse.
Okay, let's go to the...
Go to Galatians chapter 6, verse 9.
Okay, go there for the second. Okay. No problem.
Galatians... 6:9.
I'm getting it fast for you, sis. I got you. Mm-hmm. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 9.
Yes.
And let us not be weary in well doing.
Exactly.
For in due season we shall reap if we faint not.
Don't faint from what?
Don't faint under that curse.
Don't faint from keeping the commandments. So you're saying that we don't have to keep, in the New Testament, we don't have to keep the commandment?
We don't have to keep the commandment of being cursed. Okay. Get out of that. Get out of that. Break that habit of feeling like I'm not going to make it. I can't do better. They got me under their foot.
You okay.
Don't have to go, for real.
Last scripture. So the opposite of being cursed is being blessed, right?
That's correct.
That's correct.
Okay, so let's get this last scripture.
22. Revelations 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life.
Go to Revelations, start at verse 7. And then
same chapter?
Yep. And then, all right. Yeah, and then go on.
Revelations 22, verse 7.
Yeah. Okay. You can't cotton pick little verses. You've got to have the whole content. You got to have the content of it. So you stopped an educator.
Okay. Let's get it.
Right. Revelation 22 and 7. Behold, I come quickly.
Yes.
Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book.
This book. Uh-huh.
Right.
New Testament.
Hold on now. So let's see what he's talking about. Go to, no, we're going to go back. Get Matthew's 4 and 4. We're going to come back. Now, we're going to come back. We're going
to
come back. I got to get this. Come on, let me get this.
No, you didn't finish.
I got to get this. Because we're talking about Christ.
7 through. You can't stop.
We're
going
to read it.
You can't stop. And then get what you
want. We're going to come back.
We're going to come.
How you going to
go? Which one? Matthew 4 and 4? Okay.
Love y'all, but I got to go. I got children. I got children to take care of.
We got you right here.
This all right, I got children to take care of. But you got to read the whole content of it. Read what came before and read what came afterwards. I got to go. But y'all need to go in there and hear that pastor preach.
No, we don't.
Dr. Wesley. I have not heard him, but for real, I have kids to take care of.
Okay, let's get this last one, for real.
Matthew 4 and 4.
This is Jesus Christ.
But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
So that's the Old and New Testament. Old and New Testament, sister.
What comes out of your mouth. Your tongue is sharper than any two-edged sword. So stop speaking curses on your life. Don't do that. Don't do that. Speak life into your life.
All right. Well, you heard what it said, every word that proceedeth out of God's mouth.
That and keep going.
That's not going to change that scripture, sister, but we love you. Let's get your name one more time.
Dr. Carol Crawford.
Thank you, Ms. Crawford. We appreciate it. We had a good time with you. All right. Shalom, Officer Mendel, D.C., and we're here with
Will.
We're here with Brother Will. Okay, so Brother Will, you got a question. Go ahead and get that.
Yeah, how does one obtain eternal life?
He wants to know how one obtains eternal life. So that's a good question, because a lot of people go to church and nobody really knows exactly how to do it. So let's get out of the Bible.
Matthew chapter 19 and verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
That's pretty plain cut right there. So the answer is, we got to keep the commandments. So now we'll get you one more. Let's go to Revelations 14 and 12.
Revelations 14 and verse 12. Oh, sorry. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
Okay, so what's your thoughts on that?
What commandments? Because that can be kind of, is it the Ten Commandments, or like what commandments is Jesus talking about? And then is it possible to keep them? And then what happens if we break the commandments? Does that mean eternal life?
Okay, it's a good question. Yeah, Matthew 5. You get the answer. Let's get that out of Matthew 5.
Matthew 5, verse 17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
So everything that's in the law and everything that's in the prophets, Christ came to.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
So he came to fulfill all prophecies written about Christ. There's a lot of them in Psalms, some in Deuteronomy, different Isaiah. Go ahead.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law.
So we're still here on the earth. We see the heavens. So we're saying not one jot or tittle, meaning a comma or a period, shall pass from the law. Keep going.
Till all be fulfilled.
Till the end of days. Keep going.
Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
So that's your answer right there, brother. So we got to keep the commandments, and it's all the commandments. So the only commandments that Christ did away with, well, not any commandments he did away with, but he did away with the Levitical priesthood. So he was a replacement, so now we don't give the sacrifices. So we could get that in Hebrews. Get that in Hebrews for the brother. Hebrews 10, where it talks about Christ becoming a high priest.
And also, he might not know the least in the kingdom, too.
Okay. Oh, yeah, you can get the least of the kingdom. Yeah, get that. Let's get that least in the kingdom.
Isaiah 66 and 24. And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me. For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched. And they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh.
You see that? So when you transgress God's laws, when you don't repent, death is waiting. Because the wages of sin is what, brother?
Death.
Okay, so what is sin? What does it mean to sin? What is sin?
Sin is disobeying God, transgressing his commandments.
My brother, let's get it. Saying that you're not going to have vices. Everybody has a vice that they deal with as far as sin. You know, Paul talked about that. So we all got things that we battle with. But at the end of the day, we got to keep God's commandments and the faith of Christ to get the kingdom. So, but like I said, a lot of churches, they teach that because you're under grace, you basically don't have to keep the commandments. Have you heard that before?
Yeah, I mean, in I know there's a passage where Paul says, he says basically, what then, shall we sin more so that grace will increase? And he says, no, may it never be. So if anybody says that grace allows you to sin, they're obviously abusing what the Bible is intending to teach. I guess my question more, because I came, because, you know, I hear a lot of things about, I don't want to mislabel you guys, so I've heard a lot. Is this Hebrew Israelites? That's a term I've heard, but I wanted to get some firsthand information instead of just assumptions in my mind. That's why I'm asking questions, to find out. So is that how you guys identify yourself, or how do you identify yourself?
Well, Hebrew is a language, but we identify ourselves. The Bible identifies us as the Israelites. So who do you think they are?
I think some of them are, some of them aren't.
So we're gonna see what the Bible says. Let's see if they the Jews according to the Bible. Read that.
Revelation chapter 2 and verse 9. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty.
So that's going into the real Israelites. They're in tribulation and poverty.
But thou art rich.
Because the kingdom of heaven is for the Israelites and only the Israelites. That's why they said, but thou art rich. You're in poverty now, but you're rich. Now keep reading.
And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan.
So that's what the Bible says those people in Israel are. They're not the Jews. They're the synagogue of Satan. So now when a lot of people hear that, that's why you hear things like, oh, they're a hate group. But did I say that, or did the Bible say that?
That passage we just read was straight out of the scriptures.
So now, let's go into the real hit, the Israelites. No, hold on. Let's finish up on them. Go to Ezekiel. I think I went 36 and 5, where it tells you who's in that land today.
Okay, I know.
You know?
Those that claim to be Jews and are not, that's within Revelation. In your perspective, who is he writing to? When? Because that's a series of, I think, seven churches that were written to. And so when he's making these comments, who is he specifically addressing them to?
He's addressing them to the Israelites. So now, as far as which church... We can read that, because I can't remember exactly what church that was.
I'll start verse 1. Revelation 2 and 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write these things, what saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks.
Okay, so now, what you got to understand about the Jewish... go ahead.
Verse 8. And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna.
Smyrna, yeah.
So, but... In reference to the Jews that are over there, or the Jewish that's over there now, those are converts. They were converted by John Hyrcanus under the Greeks. he converted them over. The Bible gives you the prophecy about them coming into Jerusalem. That's what we're about to get right now.
That's my main goal, is, you know, just to learn more. So you said to the angel of the church of Ephesus, angel of the church of Laodicea and Smyrna. Church is a New Testament term. How are you guys, so just so I understand, how are you using the word church? Like, what does it mean? Do you see it as synonymous with Israel, or is it something distinct?
We're gonna get it for you right here.
Sorry about that. Thank you, man. All right, X. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people, and the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. Yeah, that's what I wanted. Acts 7 and 38. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel.
So who was in the church? Let's just get the kingdom of heaven for the brother. This would be the last one, and then we're going to move on.
Scripture here mentioned.
Revelations 21 and 12.
Revelations chapter 21 and verse 12.
You can read the whole thing, but we're going to get right to the point.
And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel.
Okay, so where are the rest of the nations going? Because we're reading it that the kingdom of heaven has 12 gates for the Israelites. So where would the rest of the nations be going?
I mean, the nations as kind of as
nations are strangers. Where are they going?
Because right there, the kingdom of heaven is telling you it's for the Israelites. You understand that? When you read it, let's read it again for the brother.
Revelations 21 and verse 12. And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel.
Okay, so where's everybody else going?
I mean, from what we just read there, I don't think that speaks specifically to where people are going or whatnot. It's talking about how heaven is created. So when you get there, the gate, there's, like it says, there's 12 gates, there's 12 angels at them, and each one of them is names of one of the tribes of Israel, Reuben, Simeon, Levi, you know, etc. So that's, to me, it's like, but I mean, we could have a gate here that's called, you know, that's L Street Bridge right there, something like that. So I don't know that that passage is talking specifically about where, you know, everybody's going to go.
It's telling you where the Israelites are going to go. But as far as everybody else, we got the scripture right here. Yeah, 1 verse 1.
Let's get the kingdom.
Kingdom of heaven, 14 and 1.
Okay. Isaiah 14 verse 1. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land.
That's the kingdom of heaven. Keep going.
And the strangers shall be joined with them.
So you got your strangers there.
And they shall cleave to the house of Jacob, and the people shall take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids, and they shall take them captives, whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors.
So what is that saying, brother?
You mean it's a prophecy, and it's talking about what God, his plans and prophecies for Israel based on how they conducted themselves in potential futures.
So what does that mean for everybody else? Because who's our oppressors that led us into captivity? Because they said they got to pay for what they did.
If this is Isaiah, I mean, it's at the time Babylon had taken the Israelites into captivity, and there were other nations throughout the past that had taken Israel into captivity and enslaved them.
Okay, I understand that, but in Isaiah, it's saying that the whole nation of Israel will be back together. So that has never happened since the split. They never came back together. You understand that? So let's get them one more. Get them two more. Get them Isaiah 11:11, where it's going to say the same thing. It's a prophecy about Israel being gathered together as one nation.
I think you missed a point on that one.
Yeah, we're going to make it clear though.
Isaiah 11:11. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from Pathros and from Cush and from Elam and from Shinar and from Hamath and from the islands of the sea.
Because we've been scattered everywhere through slavery. Keep reading.
And he shall set up an ensign for the nations and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah.
That's the two kingdoms of Israel. Keep going.
From the four corners of the earth. The envy also of Ephraim shall depart, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off.
So down that hatred that they had towards each other, that's going to be gone. So Christ is going to gather them and put them back together underneath the Christ, the kingdom that's going to be set up. So when we read in Isaiah 14, it's letting you know that when those leaders get set up, you got to have subjects, because we're not going to be doing our own works in the kingdom of heaven. So somebody got to do that work, and that's going to be the people that are oppressing us now.
Oh, okay, I see what you're saying.
It shows us who we are. We can link our slavery to the Bible and tell that we're the children of Israel, God's chosen people.
Right.
So that's what we were sharing with him, because this information is not privy to our people. They don't teach us this in school.
No school.
None of your educational institutions or religious institutions, you're going to find this information.
Right.
That's why we got to come out here, because there's a media blackout on us. We got YouTube and all that stuff, but they're not going to put us at the top of the feeds for you, you see? You got to actually search us out.
So reading this, I'm about to get educated somewhat. I'm going to learn something that I didn't know.
You're going to learn a lot you didn't know about yourself, your lineage, your nation.
Is y'all Muslim, man?
No, sir. We are the Israelites. We are God. We believe in the Bible.
Y'all got a holiday, too.
We got a lot of high holidays.
No, it's a serious holiday.
We got more than...
Chop a head off holiday type motherfucking holiday before midnight. Chop a head off.
What kind of holiday is that?
All white people. All white people. No.
Oh, no.
That's some jail shit. No, that's some jail shit. I learned that in jail.
No, man.
I'm going to read look, this. Is the phone number on there?
Yeah, look, man.
I fuck with knowledge.
This is vital information to all of us.
Right.
This is the cause and effect of how we got into the situation we in now, and these conditions where they got to go to black offices.
Right.
And how we get out is biblical. You're not going to find the solution in it. You can try to, your politics and your economics and all this stuff, you can try to, but guess what? The Bible say that this nation that God set up over us, we go to them and hope that they can help us, but God don't want to put us in that situation. So, like for instance, I'm gonna read one scripture, but
he led us out. He freed us
from Egypt.
For us to get captured once again.
Guess what? As long as we in sin,
and captivate ourselves.
As long as we in sin, guess what?
The children
of Israel went into captivity over and over and over and over again. Because why? Every time he delivered us from captivity, we would go right back and start sinning again and go right back, and we forgot why we went to captivity in the first place.
Right.
So we'd go right back into it.
So, hold on a second.
4:17. Book of Lamentations, chapter 4. Read 2:14-17, then go to 4:17.
Book of Lamentations, chapter 2:14. Thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee.
So God is saying that our prophets, which is talking about nowadays, the pastors, they have seen vain and foolish things for us. So when you go to church nowadays, they don't teach you who you are according to the Bible. They don't teach you none of that.
Right.
The important stuff, keeping God's commandments and laws. They don't teach none of that in the church. So they see vain and foolish things like, if you give me your tithe money, you're going to be blessed. You know what I'm saying? Or the prosperity doctrine. Stuff like that. So these are some of the vain and foolish things that our prophets have seen for us. Go ahead.
And they have not discovered thy iniquity.
They have not discovered our iniquity. Iniquity here is talking about sin when you're reading Psalms.
Yeah.
So they haven't discovered our iniquities to let us know what sins we're in so that we can correct it, so that we can come out of these conditions. Go ahead.
To turn away thy captivity.
Because when they discover our iniquity so that we can fix it, it will turn away our captivity. We won't be in slavery if we come out of our sins and we keep God's laws. But as long as we in sin, we're going to be in captivity.
Right.
Go ahead.
But they have seen for thee false burdens and caused for banishment.
Go ahead.
All thy that pass have clapped their hands at him.
So everybody that passed, they clapped their hands at us. Go ahead.
They have hissed and wagged their heads at the daughter of Jerusalem.
So they hiss and they wag their head at us. Damn, this is... Now finish it out, then I'm going to bring it full circle.
Saying, is this the city that man called the perfection of beauty?
Is this God's chosen people?
The Israelites.
Are these really the people that God chose? Look right. at the conditions we live in.
Look at it.
The ghetto.
Right.
Our sisters who portrayed us harlots all over the media. And that's how they are treated as well. You know what I'm saying? The men are not taking care of their families, marrying our sisters.
Man is out of position. The woman receiving the blessing. The woman now got to give it to the man because man is out of position.
The man is out of order, so the woman is out of order.
True.
So the man got to get in order first. But this is what the nations are doing. Now you can jump over to 417. So this is what they're doing tonight with this Black Caucus meeting that they have.
Wow.
Lamentations 4, verse 17.
Uh-huh.
As for us, our eyes have yet failed for our vain help.
They seeking vain help because they looking for help from the people that put them in this position. Go ahead.
In our watching, we have watched for a nation that has not saved us.
We have watched for many years. How long have we been over here? 400 something years?
Oppressed.
We have watched for many years oppressed. For a nation to help us that cannot help us. They are not going to.
You're
going to
ask the oppressors to help you?
Right.
It's not working.
This is what the Bible says.
No, no, no.
So, to answer your other question, go to Ezekiel 39.
I got to go to the car.
Okay, yeah. All right.
I got the lit. And I like. Knowledge, because you like you said, they ain't give us none of this.
They not.
So all the little bit that we can get, it's like if a person got an ear, oh, you gonna stop to listen.
Yeah,
it's real.
Everybody that's of the Most High, they gonna hear His words. So that's why Christ said.
To target law enforcement officers. I believe earlier you said you were not familiar with the report. Is that correct?
Well, I haven't read it. I know some of the alleged targeting of officers by
okay, so I would
group.
Like to know, and I'll ask you about that in a minute. So you are somewhat familiar with it. Who had the power in your department to order a report like this?
I'm not sure how that report got ordered. I don't believe I explicitly approved it or directed it.
Okay, so...
I'm not able to comment on that. I'm not I have not so declared it.
So you should know that a lot of activists around the country are very concerned that we're getting ready to repeat a very sad chapter of our history.
Thank you, sir. The chair recognizes the gentlewoman from California, Ms. Bass, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Mr. Director, for being here with us. The idea that document was distributed to law enforcement nationwide, and also the concern that the message that sends to many local law enforcement agencies and how you distinguish between what might be problematic behavior and also what is people just exercising their First Amendment rights. And so
now the gentlewoman from California, Ms. Bass, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You do remember me. We've had a couple of conversations about black identity extremists and about that report. And I've asked both of you at different times if you would look into the matter further. And I didn't actually hear back. And so I want to ask you questions that I've asked before. Spurred an increase in retaliatory violence. So I've tried to get to the bottom of where this report came from, who did it, what its status is. I've asked Attorney General Sessions, I've asked Director Ray, and so now I want to ask you.
I wanted to get that on the record. I wanted to appreciate you stepping up.
Oh, you're very welcome.
You know, and I know it takes a lot of guts, a lot of courage, especially in that background. But a lot of people don't. And we do know that. So I do want to thank you.
I appreciate that.
You did a good job handling that.
Thank you.
with a lemon.
Wait a minute.
Not cause she ain't living.
Wait.
It's just
wait
your
a minute.
Eyes get acidic. And this ain't
wait.
A scrimmage.
Wait a minute.
We ain't finished.
What?
I told
wait
you we won't stop. Bada bada business.
Wait a minute.
Like yours, but you're renting.
What?
Wave hello to the top. The bay wrong glide.
Wait a minute.
Tell the paparazzi get the lens rod.
Wait a minute.
Got the window down top blown.
Okay, I'm Mendel, D.C., IUIC, D.C., and I'm with?
Silk Little John.
Okay.
Angela Lucky.
Okay, and what are y'all doing here today?
Enjoying all the festivities. I mean, the prayer breakfast was awesome. Awesome.
Okay. What do you hope to see accomplished out of this prayer breakfast?
Oh, my gosh. I just hope that everybody was listening. I mean, I'm tired of telling everybody to stay woke. And it seems like no matter what we say, everyone's turning a deaf ear to our voices unless we're directly confronted with adversity. Then that's when everybody's open and want to, you know, wake up. And even then, they're still daydreaming. So I just hope that everyone is actually listening, just paying attention, and then doing the work. Just do the work. Stop saying, I understand, pray about it. But prayer without work is nothing.
Let's get that for the sister. Get that James 2:17. We're going to get that for you, sister. Hold on real quick.
This is from the book of James, chapter 2, and verse 17. Give me a second, y'all. James chapter 2 and verse 17. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works.
Okay, so sister, yeah, you see that. That's exactly how it goes. But sister, I don't know if you are familiar with our organization, but we're Israel United in Christ, and we do actually go out on the streets and do ministry work.
Awesome.
And we go out pretty much. We got people out there 7 days a week.
Awesome.
Out there on the streets teaching the people who they are according
that's
to the Bible. And teaching our people to keep the commandments of God. So, are you familiar with? Yes. So, are y'all familiar with Israel United in Christ? Are you, sister?
No.
I'm not familiar with the organization per se, but I most definitely have followed you on social media, especially Facebook, on when you're out in the communities marching. And I was always interested because there's so many of you when you take the streets. And I think you guys are doing a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful job.
Well, you know, we need good sisters to back us up. You know, the sisters, get Genesis 2. Let's get that. Genesis 2, I think I want 18. About being the help meet. You know what I want? Is that right?
Genesis.
Let's get that right there.
This is Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an help meet for him.
You see that? So women are essential. Yes. To help the men do the things that they need to do.
Yes.
So we definitely need our sisters. So what we got here? Okay, I appreciate y'all, sisters.
She's a former
okay, so.
NAACP, and she ran for mayor, and I'm a former, well, actually, she's a present NAACP member. Grand Prairie, Texas, and I'm a former president of the NAACP in Arlington. So we're definitely in the movement, but we move by Christ. You know, he orders our steps.
Amen.
And because he orders our steps, then every move we make is on time.
Okay, we definitely agree with that, sisters. We appreciate y'all.
Thank you.
But you can look us up also, sisters, and I'll make sure that we look y'all up.
And can you text me on my telephone?
Yeah. Yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, you know, we have a, give her a flyer, because we have a school local Bible where you can learn about your history, because according to the Bible, we're the Israelites. So, and the reason why we suffer all these oppressions is because we broke God's commandments and he put curses on us. That's why we're at the bottom of society. Because if you ever wonder, every major city you go to, we're at the bottom.
Right. Can you come to Dallas, Texas?
We got a school there in Dallas.
Really?
Yeah, we do.
I don't ever see
them. Oh, yeah, they are in the streets. Well, the marching is, that was for the men's conference. So we do it on smaller levels, we do that. But a main part of what we do, the march was to bring attention to the organization. Yeah, I'm sure that they can do that, but you can also look us up online. We got a lot of stuff there where y'all can learn.
Congratulations. Right, thank you for your work.
I appreciate y'all, sisters. Any last thing you want to say?
Well, I just, you know, want to encourage everyone, and especially your organization, thank you for everything that you're doing. But, you know, at the end of the day, we still got to take many people to the poll, and we have to vote in order to be able to change who get put into office, even on the local level. We got to make sure that felons that are eligible to vote, because I know from state to state requirements changes, but we got to make sure even when felons regain their voting rights that they go to the poll and vote, because their votes is making a difference in these local elections, because it starts at the local.
Well, what we teach here is that we teach that the difference is going to be made by keeping and teaching God's commandments. So when you look at Chicago with the high murder rates, that's a biblical problem. It's not a political problem. So I want to get one more scripture for you. Get Lamentations 4:17 for the sister.
And then Zephaniah 2:1.
Okay. This is Lamentations chapter 4 and verse. Okay. This is Lamentations chapter 4 and verse 17. As for us, our eyes as yet failed for our vain help. In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
Because the United States is not designed to save the so-called African American. It's not, the system is not designed to save us. So we going to the polls and voting, it's not going to save us. Let's find the solutions. Go to Zephaniah 2:1. Let's get that.
This is the book of Zephaniah, chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
So that Bible is talking about us. We're a people that's not desired. Because why is it that, like, we have the Black Congressional Caucus? I don't see an Asian Congressional Caucus. I don't see an Arab Congressional Caucus. But yet these people, they'll show up into our communities, open up businesses, and thrive. We can't even open up stores in our own businesses. And the reason why is Amos 3:3. Amos 3:3. Let's get this. We're going to show you why we can't do that.
This is from Amos. Hold on. Amos chapter 3 and verse 3. Hold on. Yep. Can two walk together except they be agreed?
We can't come together because, for one, we don't know our history. We don't know who we are or what we're supposed to do. We can't, if one guy's a Muslim, another guy's a 5%er, another guy's a Christian, how can we come together and work together with all different doctrines and things like that? So what we have to understand is that according to God, we're the Israelites. That's according to the Bible. Then once we come to that realization, we have to keep God's commandments,
right,
and the faith of Christ.
Walks in the body of Christ. A lot of people don't know who they are, where they come from. And because they're not educated, what you have to do is you have to come down on a different level to them. Some people can't hear every voice. So that means that it takes different tones for people to understand. You know how you say deaf, some people are deaf tone. Well, everybody can't hear your voice. So you have to meet them where they are. And a lot of people, that's the problem. A lot of us don't want to meet our brothers and sisters where they are. They need, their expectations are up here, where someone else is not there. They don't even know how to get there. Their journey is totally different. So if we can just meet people where they are, educate them, give them knowledge, let them know the true history, our history, right, not his story, but our story, then we can come together and we can make progress. Well, I got to do it.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. What you're
like
doing.
You're doing. Oh, yeah. We appreciate y'all. We are on the street, sisters. We appreciate our sisters, and thank you for stopping and talking to us.
Thank you
for doing this.
Oh, yeah, we appreciate you.
Yes. Appreciate
it.
Was
a pleasure.
In Mendel, D.C. I'm here with
Ronald Boyd DeVoe Jr. Everything is in a name. Ronald Boyd DeVoe Jr.
All right, it's a pleasure to be with you, and I recognize you from New Edition. Anyway, so So what do you hope to accomplish by coming here today with the religious leaders, the political leaders? What's going on, brother?
Entertainment leaders, yeah. Business leaders, DeVoe Real Estate is my company, okay. Right? I've been doing real estate since 2002.
Okay.
And here in America, 2 years later, 2004, we reached the peak of black ownership, right?
Okay.
Less than 50%. everybody else in America, 67, 68, 69, and 70 plus percent home ownership, right? The peak, 2004, is back down to 40, where it was before 1968 and the Fair Housing Act and all of that, right? Crisis lows. So I'm here to connect and make sure that I can get that word out. And home ownership ultimately is the key to generational wealth. That's where it starts at. So if we don't own homes, we don't own wealth. So that's my message. That's why I'm here.
Okay, Wes, I appreciate that. So one quick word with you on that. As far as getting people to that level where they can look at real estate and some of these different things, would you think that trying to get their minds right first? Because yes, you can't go into something like that without having your mind right.
No, so that's why we connect with other like-minded real estate professionals that understand and are educated on how to do it the right way, right? Okay. So we make it so that people can make informed and educated decisions. But you have to get the information. A lot of us don't even believe that it's achievable, you know, when it is, you know. And but the right mind state, like you said, you know.
Well, you're talking about on a business mind level, but I'm talking about on a spiritual mind level. Because a lot of people, I got you.
But the pastor said, at some point, the prayer got to be over, and we got to put in work. Ain't nothing wrong with prayer and the law of attraction. It's all kind of interconnected, basically. What you believe, what you speak about comes back to you, but what you going to do with it, you know, ultimately. So, yeah, that's what it's all about.
Okay.
Love y'all.
Words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I'll rise. Is there anybody in here who wants to rise on this night? But here's what the Word of God says, because the Word of God teaches us that you and I don't have to settle for less. Do I have a witness?
Officer Mandel, D.C., and I'm with
Vernon Walton.
Okay, Mr. Walton, you said Walton?
Walton,
W.L. Walton, okay, Mr. Yep. Walton, what brings you here today?
I wanted to come and be a part of the prayer breakfast. It's one of the rich tradition, one of the rich traditions of this particular week, and it's always an inspiring event. And let me tell you, Dr. Howard John Wesley certainly challenged us today as a community.
Okay, so let me ask you this. I get a couple questions here, because I know here we got political leaders. We have some. We've seen some entertainers. Mm-hmm. We've seen, of course, a lot of religious leaders. What do you think they hope to accomplish by bringing all these people together?
Well, I think, you know, when everybody comes together, we recognize that there's power in numbers. And I think that each of those identities that you just raised has influence in those particular areas, those arenas. Okay. And while we have varying approaches, the message is always the same. That there's power in numbers, and that's important that we focus on empowering our people and getting out and vote and become engaged in policy.
Okay, so I would definitely agree with you on that. So basically what we're out here to show our people is who they are according to the Bible and why that's important. Because a lot of our people don't know who they are or what role history plays in where we are today. Because when we think about Black history, we typically think about slavery. But what about before slavery? Where were we?
Well, I think, you know, before slavery, we were thriving in our own country. We were thriving as a people in our own land. As some say, some came here by the Nina, the Pinta, the Santa Maria. We didn't ask to come. We were brought here.
Okay, so then that would say, not to cut you off, but so we were over there in our own country, but who were we in our own countries?
When you say who were we were strong people. We were strong Black people. And we were accomplishing goals. We were strong in family relationships. We were strong in economics. You know, we were creating our own industry. And unfortunately, that process was interrupted by, you know, our coming here. But it's in moments like this we realize that we cannot wait for people to do for us what we can do for ourselves. Okay. That there's a sense of accountability that we have for our own.
I would agree with that. Hey, Jess, let's get the brother a scripture real quick. Zebaniah, 2-on-1. Who? I'm going to get him. All right, I get him.
Man, I appreciate you.
Okay, you got to go.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I appreciate you. Thank you, man.
It's putting money in black banks. It's making those black banks accountable, and then we can now turn around and hire from within our community. We got to do things that we can mandate and that we can control. And banking black, more importantly, just banking black, but financing black, is truly a conversation that needs to be had across the country. And so for us, it's one step that we can make sure that our communities are getting done.
Mendel, D.C. Camp, and I'm here with
Ron Buzzy, President and CEO of the U.S. Black Chambers, Inc.
Okay, so why don't you let me know what you're doing here, what you hope to accomplish, and what your role is in helping the black community.
The U.S. Black Chamber was founded here in Washington, D.C. in 2009, and at the time we had 6 black chambers. Today we have over 142. We're in 42 states and have over 300,000 black-owned businesses. The reason that we're here this year, as we've been in the last 10 years, is to really grow, prosper, learn best practices, develop relationships across the country to make sure that we can move our communities forward collectively with one voice.
Okay, so on the business, so you're in the business aspect of helping start black businesses, which
start
I think
and grow.
Start and okay and grow. Okay, I think that's very admirable. We definitely need that because when you look at a lot of our communities, we don't have a lot of black businesses. Like when you go to Baltimore, you go to Chicago, parts of D.C., where we make up 95% of the community, we don't own any of the businesses there. Why do you think that is?
I think there's a lot of reasons. I think some of the reasons have to do with, obviously, gentrification. But I think a lot of black businesses are now virtual. We don't have the brick-and-mortar business that we had in the past, where you could always go to a MLK Street or a Malcolm X Street and find black-owned businesses, as I did when I was growing up in the city of Oakland, California. But today, you can find us online. The U.S. Black Chamber has created a mobile directory, a mobile app. On your phone, there's 114,000 black-owned businesses there, GPS-driven. So you can find us. It's just diligency to make sure that we are doing what's right in our communities by our communities.
Okay, so let me ask you this, because we're men of the Lord here. So what role do you think that men of God have to play in helping to build our communities business-wise and everything else? What's your thoughts on that?
Well, as a son of a preacher, better known as a preacher's kid, I understand that the role that the church plays. The church has allowed us to have leadership, develop those leaders, have a voice to our communities, and to be able to say morally what our communities need to do. The church role has never diminished. I think it's more important today than it's ever been. And so I think the other thing in reference to the church is they're one of the larger funders in our communities. You can go any Sunday and go to a local community church, and you'll see that the members of that church are making sure that they're donating or tithing in those churches. The responsibility now is on that church to make sure it's taking those dollars and reinvesting those dollars back into our communities. Many churches are depositing those dollars in banks that no longer make loans in our local communities. A church can make its deposit on Monday and go find a loan or look for a loan on Tuesday, and that same bank will deny that loan. We got to make sure that we're being responsible with the church's coffers as well as its members.
Well, I'm going to tell you, it's been my experience because our group, we go to a lot of inner city neighborhoods to reach our people on the street level. So, and a lot of times in those communities, we see churches on every corner.
Exactly.
But the churches have failed the communities. It appears that a lot of our political figures have failed the communities, because when you look at a lot of our neighborhoods, such as Baltimore being close here, they're run by the people that we've been told we need to vote for to get our people up out of the bottom, but that hasn't seemed to help. So how important do you think it is to know, for our people to know their history? Because as a people, we don't have a history. Would you agree that that would be an issue to help build further a history and a culture that's been taken away?
Well, the Bible says that the lack of knowledge is the reason that our people will perish. And so with that in mind, I think we need to understand our history. I'll give you a great example, maybe not necessarily in Baltimore, but in Virginia. During the unrest of the Charlotte riots, folk were upset. Obviously, there was a concern about us taking down the statues. But I'm more impressed and more astute about our future. That same day that the Charlottesville in Southern Virginia was happening, we also lost the only black bank that we had in Virginia. So I'm concerned about our future as well as I am about our past. And when we talk about our future, we got to make sure that we're doing things that are concerned about the future of our communities.
Okay, so I'm going to get one thing for you, and I'm going to let you go. But according to the Bible, we're God's chosen people. We're the Israelites. So I'm going to give you a scripture. Come here, Jess. And I'm going to show you Amos 3:1 for the brother right here.
Amos chapter 3 and verse 1. Hear this word that the Lord... Zephaniah. Okay, Zephaniah. Okay, let me hold that down. So, Zephaniah chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
So the Bible's telling our nation to gather ourselves together because we're not desired. But in order to gather ourselves together, this is what we got to do.
Amos chapter 3 and verse 3. Can two walk together except they be agreed?
A lot of times the reason why our things don't work out because we're not on the same mind. You understand that? We don't know who we are or what we're supposed to be doing. So who we are, we're the Israelites, and what we're supposed to be doing is God's commandments. That way we would know how to treat each other, know how to love each other. Our communities wouldn't be the way they are now. But we definitely appreciate you, brother, because without brothers like you helping to promote building of businesses and things like that, we'd be that much further behind. So definitely appreciate you taking the time. Your name again?
Ron Busby, B-U-S-B-Y.
It's been a pleasure, brother.
We're here today that we might lift those boats that are stuck on the bottom, full of unpolished pearls. That we might elevate the common lot of humanity and build a new functional rainbow coalition, spanning lines of color, sex, race, religion, region, and national origin.
Officer Mendel, D.C., here with
Reverend Jesse Jackson.
Reverend Jesse Jackson, it's an honor to meet you. Okay, I got
on this holy occasion.
On this holy occasion, yes, sir. I got a couple questions for you. Our people, well, it seems like some of these politicians have been there for a long time, and I know you've been fighting for our people for years and years and years. When you look at some of our communities, like when you look at Baltimore, when you look at Chicago, when you look at some of the other places where we have a heavy presence, it seems like the political system has failed our people. What role do you think us as religious leaders have to play in that, or what things could we do to benefit our people?
The political system is just one phase of our struggle. The next phase is economic. Then we're in position, mayors can give out contracts for the first time. Okay. Congress people can pass legislation for the first time. So in some sense, it's not the seniority of our leaders, the seniority of racism. We're looking at a system now that is made sick by its leadership, whether it's fighting Mexico and Canada at the same time, or fighting the G7 in Europe. There's something sick of coming from the White House. But we have the power to heal that disease, voting it out of office 2020.
Okay. So now, let me ask you this, because in some of our communities at a local level, they've been voting the way that they've been told to vote. But yet, at a local level, they've been, you know, our people have been failed. So I'm wondering what role you think the church can play in trying to get our people. Because when you look at problems like in Chicago and Baltimore, you have a high murder rate. That's a biblical problem when we talk about thou shalt not kill. I don't see politically.
They're not listening to political leaders. Political leaders are not encouraging them to kill each other. People get trapped up in drugs and guns in and jobs out. Sometimes they lose their way. No political leader encourages blacks to kill each other. And we have the power to stop it, and we must stop it. We must break the cycle of self-destruction. We, the people, must break the cycle of self-destruction.
Okay, I understand that. I appreciate your time, Mr. Jackson. Del D.C., and I'm here with
Reverend Claudia Harrison.
Reverend Alfred Harrison.
Okay, so it's good to have y'all here. So what brings y'all here today?
Well, we've always been excited about the CBC prayer breakfast in particular because it gives us a charge of what we need to do as African Americans and as citizens and as Christians to move our people forward.
Okay, so how many years have y'all been coming?
It's been about 5 years.
And both of y'all are pastors of a church, I'm assuming?
Yes, we are missionaries in Africa, as well as we oversee an outreach center over in Southeast D.C., Angels of Hope Ministries.
Have you ever wondered why it is that it seems that our people at the bottom in all communities across the country? Have you ever wondered about that? And what do you think is the reason behind that?
Well, definitely. That's always an issue, particularly when we serve an underserviced and unprivileged community in Washington, D.C., in the nation's capital, and see poverty as a long-serving, systematic situation with our young people and with our neglected elderly. And I think it's an aspect that we don't really realize that we need to really reach out. We need to realize that we didn't get where we are by our own bootstraps and remember where we came from. And as my wife often says to the young people, we need to remember to give back, and we've got to level that playing ground, level that table.
Okay, so we're a faith-based organization, Israel United of Christ. I'm not sure if you're familiar with us, but we go out to the streets and teach the people. And the foundation of what we teach is that we're the biblical Israelites and that we're commanded to keep God's commandments. And that's the solutions to cleaning up our people. Because when you look at a city like Baltimore or when you look at Chicago where they have a high murder rate, those aren't political problems, they're biblical problems. So us as men of the Lord, we got to go out there and let our people know that and teach them on a street level. And it sounds like you're doing some of that, going to places in Africa and those various places. You say you're in Southeast D.C.?
Yes, exactly. And our Sunday pulpit is sometimes in the parking lot of the underprivileged complexes there in Southeast D.C. So we definitely honor those who go out, because we are the temple of God. And if we're the temple of God, then we are the ones who are to carry God to the people. We can't build the buildings, raise the funds, and expect them to come to us. We got to take the ministry, the gospel, and the word of God, and the representation of God back to where the people are. And that's how we draw them.
Okay. So now I have this question, because I know we have a lot of congressmen and different people, and they have different things, agendas that they're pushing. One of the things that's really being pushed right now is homosexuality. As us as leaders, spiritual leaders, how can we join with people that promote not just that, but abortion, all different types of things that go directly against the Bible? So what is our responsibility in that regard?
Well, our responsibility is that we don't compromise, we don't take a stand, that we don't compromise, but we take a stand on the principles of God. Whenever we move away from that, we see the wrath of God, and we see God moving us in a different direction. And so therefore, even as Christians, as men of God, as Israelites, we need to continue to take a stand for the things that God has determined and laid out in His Bible and in His Word. And that's uncompromisable. It's not political. It's not social. It's not a phase. It's not a fad. But it's what God says that matters, because the word is what goes forth and does not return void.
I like to hear that, brother, because we got a lot of people that's been into that agenda. You understand what I'm saying? So
it's popular. We feel we have to appease. But that percentage of population is not as high as it says it is. It's not. It's not even anywhere near where it says it is. We don't judge. We don't judge. We don't ostracize. We want to bring everybody to Christ, but we don't lower our standard and we don't compromise.
Well, according to the Bible, we don't condemn, but we have to, as men of the Lord, we got to judge them and let them know that they're in error. You know, it's our responsibility. So when we deal with political leaders and they want to push, you know, those agendas, should we tell our people to vote for these people when they got these type of agendas, or how is that handled?
Well, I think we need to weigh it that we're not looking for them to be our priest, but we have to be their priest, and we have to confront them where they are, and we have to vote where our issues and our concerns and our standards place us. So it is a matter of, no, we're not compromising to vote for anyone who does not have our agenda and in best interest and is not leading us in the direction, particularly as Christians, where we want to go. I believe one of the reasons why we lost the 2016 election was not because of the evangelicals and not because of Donald Trump. It was because we strayed away in our principles from godly principles as well. So that lost a lot of black vote and lost a lot of vote from the church. Even though we had a first African-American president, it lost where we stood. We compromised a little bit. And whenever you compromise a little bit, you risk a consequence. So no, I do not advocate voting for those who are against standards and principles. But I do believe that we are in a place at the table to hold them to their convictions, to hold them to the calling that's on their life, and to hold them to the principles of God.
Okay, so now as far as like some of the candidates running on the abortion or running on the homosexual ticket or some of the other things that they run on, as far as, you know, I would never support anything like that, you know, or be able to go to a voting booth or do anything like that.
That's your personal conviction. I don't discourage anyone from voting, but I do encourage everyone to be in place, to hold them accountable, to speak up, and then what do you say? If we don't tell them, the blood will be on our hands.
I hear you there, brother.
The first conviction that we have is to spread the word, to preach the gospel uncompromising, so that we can hold them to the convictions that we vote them into upholding.
Okay, thank you, brother. We appreciate that, man. Yes, sir.
Okay, first of all, here's your deal. And this is the problem. Republicans are always talking about how they don't like for folks to brand them as being racist or bigots, and I understand that.
Black man who marries a white woman will not get your respect.
Can I respond?
Yeah, go ahead.
And what I'm telling you is this. I don't care who you name. I don't care how much work you did for black people. Your greatest commitment to black people is being committed to a black woman. It is still a contradiction. No matter how much you think you did for the struggle, if you really were concerned with black people, you would commit yourself to a black woman.
Come on over here.
We went up to the Swedes and
yeah. 15 plus years.
Okay, so let me ask you, what type of changes do you think that they're going to try to bring in to help our communities?
Well, first and foremost, part of the problem is that Republicans control the Senate, and so you could pass something in the House, but if it can't get through the Senate, it's not going to get it passed. But you still have some things that have happened. Like, for instance, the 2018 Farm Bill, there were a number of things that the CBC added to that Farm Bill that helped HBCUs, that helped rural communities. And so there are things that seem like still be done. But remember, it's our job to also make it clear to elected leaders what we want them to do.
Okay, so one more question. It seems like at a local level, these politicians have failed our communities.
How so? You had to find that. That's a general statement. How so?
Well, like, we spend a lot of time in the inner city, our organization. So
no,
when
but
we
still, but you, yeah, but where? So yes, still
Baltimore, Detroit.
Right, which means that the people in those cities should be holding those people responsible back because that's where they live.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at. That's what I'm getting at. I agree with you there.
Right.
But I'm just wondering, because a lot of those people have been voting the way they've been told to vote, and it seems like the politicians they have in there have not really performed for
which themselves. Is why the folks need to have run somebody else who can be different. Okay. See, again, though, complaining about it does nothing.
Okay,
actually stepping up and saying, running people, running candidates, that's how you actually do it.
Okay.
The other places where you've had people who actually said, you know, we want to change, and they got out there, they mobilized, they organized, and they ran folks for office. That's what you got to do.
But we definitely appreciate
cool.
your time, man.
Appreciate
yes, sir.
Thanks a bunch.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Evil. It's a demonic principality. And only when we understand that the politics of the world, of the cosmos, has to be understood in terms of the biblical idea.
Hebrew Israelites?
Hebrew is a language. So we're the Israelites.
It can also be a name of a people.
Yeah, it can be if they name themselves Hebrew. Yeah, if they do. But now we're the Israelites according to the Bible.
Okay, you're the Israelites?
Yes. So are you, brother. Where are you descend from, your ancestors?
Wherever the black people started.
Okay, so then that was on the cargo slave ships.
Well, no, that's not true.
Well, I'm talking about here.
No, I wasn't talking about. See, I got a global vision.
Okay.
So I start at the beginning.
Okay.
So I don't start with America.
Okay. So we're gonna get the beginning. Get I want to get. Okay, we're gonna get Galatians. Nah, we got you. What's your name, brother?
Reverend Eugene F. Rivers III.
My man. It's an honor to meet you, Reverend. No, no, so we're going to get this name? For you. I'm Mendel from D.C., okay, Officer good. Mendel.
Galatians chapter 4, verse 26. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all.
So that's the motherland, according to the Bible. So you're right. That's where we come from. Okay. But our history's been erased, so a lot of us don't know that we come from there.
Okay. All right, so let me just say this real quick, all right, because I got to go. I wanted to be respectful. No, and I'd like you.
Yeah,
right. My thing is, I'm an original. The first human being is black. The first human being. Okay, so the first human being is black. And so I descend from the original man.
Newly elected Tyler City Council District 3 Council Member Shirley McKellar was sworn into office. McKellar won in the runoff race last month, beating Pamela Phinehas.
Of Smith County, I'm so proud to be able to go to Washington, D.C. to represent District 1 because all Texans deserve great economic growth, education, security, and the pursuit of individual liberty. It's all about education and opportunity. I, Shirley McKellar, can bring that to District 1. Thank you.
Teaching our people their history according to the Bible.
Oh.
And the problems are, like when you look at our communities, our problems are biblical, not political. Mm-hmm. Understand? When you look at Chicago, you got high murder rate.
The world is
different. Yeah. Yeah, but a lot of our people think that the way to solve our problems is through politics. When you look over the years, politics has failed us as a whole. And we have more problems in our communities.
Understand that? Well,
so
the thing I think is that politics is everything to include in the churches.
Yeah,
the whole world is political.
Yeah, it has been. So that's our fire right there. So what did y'all ladies get out of this coming today? First of all, who are you?
Oh, my name is Sharon.
You got church.
Hi, I'm Glenda Lynn, Northern Virginia.
Okay, Northern Virginia.
I'm Dr. Charlie McKellar, and I'm City Council for Tyler, Texas.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. So we're a faith-based organization. We go to the streets. We teach our people that they got to come back to keep God's commandments.
Yeah.
So that's what's lacking in our communities. When you look at single-family homes where you don't have a father in the home, when we look at the drugs and the crime and things like that, that's what we're about teaching. So we believe that the bulk of our problems are biblical. You understand that? So, like I said, the foundation is starting at the home.
Yes,
we don't, we don't have any fathers in the home, so that's a big problem.
Yes,
we lost all of that. So we lost all our morals. We got brothers out here creating babies. They don't take care of their children. They're not being the men that God has instructed us to be. So that's a bulk about. And then also the fact that we don't have a history. Because when you look at our history, when we talk about black history, our black history is Martin Luther King, Harriet Tubman, and those are great people in history. But what about the 5,000 plus years of history before that? What were we doing? Because when you look at America, we've just been assimilated in. None of our history has been included. Understand that? So
well, if you don't write your history, it won't get written or it'll get written incorrectly.
Well, unfortunately for us, God has written our history in the Bible.
Yeah, that's where we all start.
Yeah, that's the beginning.
That's why we say it's the Alpha and the Son.
Yeah, Alpha and Omega.
Mm-hmm. Even in the beginning, there were fatherless children.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
But we took care of our own. So
in the beginning of the Bible, there were fathers who had children who were not in their household.
But I'm saying that
they were slaves.
But what I'm saying is that the men around there helped take care of their family, but they didn't have a father there. There's rules set up in the Bible.
The Lord has always set up the rules for us to do that, but we have always done it our way.
Exactly.
This is nothing new under the sun. A young man just got up in the session with Senator Booker talking about. He's 18 years old in Chicago, and it's cyclical. I grew up in the Robert Taylors of Chicago, and I'm almost 70 years old.
We were just in Chicago.
The same things were going on. We had a family reunion one year, and we couldn't do it. It was in the Stony Island Hotel in the park across the street, and the disciples had already taken it over.
So we got to take our streets back.
you got to do. I don't know if y'all are familiar with, we had a big march in Chicago probably about 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, we started.
What is your group? It's called
Israel United in Christ.
Reunited.
Yeah, so
reunited,
like, no, Israel United.
Israel, Israel. Yeah, so, oh, okay.
Yeah, because according to the Bible, we're the Israelites. And the reason why we're the Bible is because we broke God's commandments.
So when you read, we need to get back to because this is terrible.
Exactly,
this is
it
terrible.
Is.
I mean, I don't understand why we don't understand that green is going to rise to the top, but we have to collectively go there together. When we know one individual, then we got to collectively live right and collectively do, you know.
I'm going to get two scriptures for y'all, sisters. You're going to get it out of the Bible. Zephaniah 2:1. Because this is talking about our people.
Zephaniah?
Yeah, 2:1.
Yep. Okay.
No, that's
it. I'm familiar with the Bible.
Oh, I'm not saying that.
Nah, y'all good.
No. All
right, listen to this. Let's talk about us here, sisters. Watch this right here.
Zephaniah 2:1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together. O nation, not desire.
See, we're not desire people. We got to gather together. But in order for us to gather together, we got to do this first. Go to Amos 3:3. Because we just can't just gather together.
So have you all moved in terms of your Bible and theology to the New Testament?
Oh, yeah. We stay in the New Testament. We'll get that for you.
And so, because you say the tribes of Israel and the chosen people, do you believe that they are Christians?
Yeah, they are.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to get that right there.
Amos 3:3. Can two walk together except they be agreed?
So in order for people to gather, they got to be on one accord.
Oh, yeah.
So now when you're talking
the
about
unity and the
New Testament, which we believe in the whole Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So get Matthew 4:4 for the sister. Matthew 4:4.
Yeah, that's why I was saying Old Testament.
Yeah, we
thought I was talking about that she didn't know the Bible.
Yeah. No, we believe in the whole Bible as a collective. This is what Christ commanded us to do. Yeah.
Matthew 4:4. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
So see that? So now one more scripture. 2 Timothy 3:16. No.
2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Keep going.
That the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works.
So we believe in the whole Bible from cover to cover. So when we read it, we'll read out as much out of the New Testament as we do the Old Testament. The bulk of the laws and commandments are written in the Old Testament. So in order to instruct the people what to do and what not to do, you got to go to the Old Testament. You know, if we just stay in the New Testament, we can read through the Gospels, and there's some instructions in there for us to do. But the majority of the laws that our people need, like on marriage, get one law for the sisters, Exodus 22:16. We're talking about single family homes, right? That's a big problem. And we read the whole Bible.
Jesus taught
from Genesis to Revelation. So we'll go from the Old Testament to the New Testament.
Jesus taught the Old Testament.
Yeah. Jesus spoke the Old Testament. So one last scripture. John.
And that's what he did. He brought it over into the new dispensation.
Exactly.
Jesus brought it to the new dispensation.
Except that in the Old Testament, he's not going to get rid of us. We don't. When we sin, we don't die. We don't have to bring animals for to get rid of our sin.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust. For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me.
We do the community
Church of Christ,
every
where
Sunday.
Where is that at?
Everywhere.
Okay.
Everywhere.
So y'all keep the Sunday Sabbath?
We don't keep a Sabbath.
Okay.
We keep the first day of the week, and we call it Sunday.
Okay.
And we commune every Sunday.
Okay.
Yeah, every first day of the week we commune. But we believe in 24/7 worship.
Okay.
So
well,
we believe in a spiritual relationship as well.
So what holidays do y'all keep?
We don't really keep any holidays. You know, we really don't. Because we know to reach people, there are places that you go where people are to reach them, and the Lord Jesus, when he walked on earth, he did that same thing.
So there are those of us who celebrate Easter and Christmas, but we celebrate the resurrection of Christ, not Easter. We celebrate the birth of Christ, the death, resurrection of Christ. So we don't get caught up in the holidays like because we work in society, we get Christmas off.
Yeah,
we honor that as a holiday, but we don't honor it as a spiritual holiday.
So now, when we say we're Christians, that means to be a follower of Christ.
So there are holidays
that Christ kept. So if you're going to follow Christ, why will we not keep the holidays?
What are the holidays? You said he.
Okay, so let's go to Matthew 26 and 18. Mm-hmm. Let's get going. Matthew 28. And this is one that we keep yearly. These are the holidays that we keep. Get that?
Matthew 26, verse 18. And he said, go into the city to such a man and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples.
So we keep the Passover. So that's because we're Israelites, that's our holiday. So now go to
What are you calling the Passover?
It's the Passover.
Because after that, when Jesus died on the cross, when he rose again, he did not celebrate Passover.
Paul kept Passover. That's Acts 20 and 5. It talks about he kept unleavened bread.
So that was a memorial. That was a memorial. And so that's what I'm saying. The way they celebrate the Passover in the New Testament, when Jesus rose from the dead, they celebrated a memorial that he was telling you to take the bread. And the
wine. You're talking about the communion.
Yeah,
that's the communion. But they kept the Passover up until 321 AD when Constantine put out a decree and orchestrated the pagan holidays in and did away with
the word. It became a memorial of the death, burial, and the resurrection. And so that he said, this was my last supper. When he gave that with his disciples, that was his last supper. So then we were to remember his death, burial, but to most importantly remember his resurrection, because that's where we now have life. And we do the same thing in our baptism, in our water baptism, and we confess and repent and we're baptized. We go down into water, regrave, and rise up out of a watery grave, and so we become new.
It's a whole bunch of them.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a whole bunch of them.
Okay. Go to Acts 2:38.
Let's see what you got.
Acts 2:38.
You got commandments on how to dress, what to eat. All of those are commandments.
Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized.
What did they ask? Go up and get the question that they asked. Start up here.
37. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins.
And that's what they had to do to be saved.
So it says repent. That means turn away from your sins. That's the most important part.
Okay, and then what else is it saying?
Because you can go in, you can be baptized in water and still come up a sinner if you don't repent.
The first thing it said, was to repent. Go ahead. What did you say?
Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins.
Go ahead on down.
And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
What is receive the gift of what? What do you receive? The gift of what?
The Holy Ghost.
And read it on.
For the promise is unto you and to your children,
and
to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call.
Okay,
That's the same thing as John 15:14, what we were about to read, or 14 and 15, where it talks about, if you love me, keep my commandments. It says
telling you that the first commandment
is being obedient.
Is being a child of God. You've got to come out of the adopted recreation relationship into an adopted relationship, and that's our responsibility. So then,
who are the children of God?
That's what
We're gonna get it for you, sister. We can't let you get away with that. Nah, we're gonna get it right here.
It says Romans 9, verse 7. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham.
Start at one.
I say the truth in Christ, I lie not. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost.
that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ, from my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh.
We're talking about the flesh.
Who are Israelites.
Talking about the Israelites.
To whom pertaineth the adoption.
So who belongs to adoption.
And the glory.
The glory of heaven.
And the covenant.
And the covenant. The old and new covenant belongs to Israel.
And the giving of the law.
And that's who the law was given to.
The Christian.
And the service of God
to receive Christ.
That's something you right here.
That was passed.
All right, let's read this last part right here, sister.
These are the fathers.
Watch this right here,
sister. Are the fathers and of whom is concerning the flesh.
We're not going to get anywhere with this because I'm going to tell you what's going on. We're reading verses basically out of context. And so
what's out of context about
this? No, when you read verses like that out of context, the whole thing, and that's why they asked Peter when he preached on Pentecost.
We just read from one on down, so I don't understand how that's out of context.
Because we just read how you receive. You said that they're separate. It says you receive the Holy Spirit, and then on down it tells you the Lord adds you to his church. That's when you're in a relationship with the Lord.
That
is becoming a child of God.
Yeah, when you repent and you go to keeping his commandments. You can't be a child of God by not keep doing what he said.
No, you just said what I just said.
Yeah.
I said that you, when you confess Jesus Christ as the Son of God, you repent of your sins, you are baptized. The reason you're baptized is because he wants you to go through the same ritual that he went through in terms of dying, rising up, being buried, and then rising up. And that's what we do as Christians. And then we become of him. And what he gives us, and in John 17, that's what I was saying, what he asked the Lord to give us to have the unity of faith was that the Holy Spirit dwell in us. And it says, when you're baptized, you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Okay,
and
so
the Lord then adds you to his church. And the Lord says that his church is where those who are his ambassadors, those who have believed, are there. And so because you believe, then the next step you have to do is obey those commandments. So your faith will take you to obey and obedience. And that's where you started in. And so I wanted you to see how you get to obedience. You don't get there just by being an Israelite or just saying that you believe. Your belief has to be activated. And first of all,
you're born an Israelite. You know, so becoming an Israelite is not like becoming a Catholic.
But you're not born into the family of Jesus Christ. Not that kind of birth.
So
the creation birth does not.
You want to be the children of God
still? The born.
You're talking about knowing Christ, right?
The born you're talking about is a physical birth. I'm telling you that now what we go through, the Israelites had a physical birth that made them chosen. Okay,
so
Christians have a spiritual birth.
That's not in the Bible. That's not in the Bible. If we go back and read that, they don't say nothing like that. So she's taking stuff out of context.
He's getting ready to pay the bill again. He's getting ready to heal your body again. He's getting ready to make a way again. Don't wait till the battle is over, but shout right now like you want to see him perform.
Officer Mandel, D.C. here with
Pastor Jamal Bryant.
Okay, I got a couple quick questions for you, Pastor.
Yeah.
When we look at, because you're in Baltimore, correct?
I just moved to
you
Atlanta.
You moved to Atlanta.
Yes.
Oh, okay. All right, I forgot about that. Yeah, you did move to Atlanta. So we come to an event like this where we're getting the politicians together with the your men of the Lord,
yes.
Women of the Lord.
Yeah.
What role do politics play in trying to get our communities back in order, or what role do we play as men of the Lord? What should we be doing?
Historically, the faith community ought to be mobilizing and informing our people to get back into the streets and do the real work. I was challenged as a pastor how deficit we have been in not going to the streets. I saw 1,000 of you taking the streets, speaking out against the issues of violence and poverty, and went back to my church and said, this is what we ought to be doing.
Okay.
So I want to just commend you all for really standing on the front line.
Okay, we appreciate that. Also, real quick, on our flyer, we're teaching our people their heritage and their history. So when you get a chance, Pastor, look it over, man. Reach out to us.
I'll do it.
Yes, sir. Pastor Jamal Bryan. Didn't have a whole lot of time with him, but we gave him a flyer. Lord's will, the brother take a look at it. Definitely appreciate the fact, you know, that march, as you can see, is reaching a lot of people. So all praises for that. And, you know, we got to reach out to these people. We can't come out here and bash everybody because people don't know. They don't know who they are. A lot of our people have been destroyed. So we got to make sure that we come with some compassion, try to work with these people to let them know what we're about. And Lord's will, they wake up, man. They wake up. But we're going to keep it moving.
Guides, we are kings, we march in faith because we believe we can change the world to what it needs, stand against our enemies because we can. Yeah, can't nothing ever stop us. Take one and another will rise up. We'll endure until we reach the end. We are gods, we are kings, demanding change because we believe we can.